So we're now going to move on to our show and share session. So I'll pop up periodically to introduce the next one. So we're probably good to go with our first show and share session. So I'm going to introduce to the stage Dave and Ren from Encounters, if they'd like to come up.
Hello everyone, my name is Dave Taylor Matthews. I'm here from Encounters Film Festival. My colleague Ren will be joining us on stage later. I'm head of audiences for Encounters and Ren is head of programme, in case I forget to say that later. I'm not sure who it was who asked the question earlier about whether or not there was going to be a return for shorts packages in cinemas, but whoever you were, thank you very much, because you've made this a lot easier. That's what we're here to talk about. If you don't know Encounters, we are an international short film festival approaching our 30th year now, based here in Bristol. It's fun to be back in our spiritual home watershed. We're an Oscar, BAFTA, BIFA, European Film Academy qualifying festival. So we have, our international competition has that kind of pedigree behind it. So we kind of hope that you trust us to deliver high quality shorts. So what I'm here to talk about, if I can get this to do something. I'll just use that. I won't just use that. What's going on here? There we go. So we are launching a new touring package for short films. It's a monthly program of short films that we'll be making available to UK cinemas to book. It's cheap. It's £20 minimum guarantee versus 20% box office. The idea is to try and make it as appealing to programmers and venues as we possibly can, because we know it can be a hard sell for everyone. They are short programs. They're 60-minute short programs, so they're short programs. The point of that is to try to give people the opportunity to experiment, really, to find out what works for your audiences. Hopefully, when we start getting back to the more kind of live event-based stuff, you'll be able to put together the 60-minute program, then followed by a Q&A with filmmakers, local filmmakers, or maybe networking sessions when those things start coming back into venues. So that's why they're quite short. And also, we know there's a lot of pressure on screens at the moment for everyone, what with 2.5-hour epics and what have you going on. All of the programs are BBFC certified. They all come with SDH subtitling for deaf and hard of hearing audiences. So there's that angle to work with for your audiences as well. If you're looking for content like that to experiment with, then please get in touch. Screeners are available a few months in advance. We're programming 6 months out so that we can give you a bit of an idea of what's coming. Just to give you a very quick idea of the types of audiences that we see at the festival for short film, 70% of our audience is under the age of 35. We tend to feel that the audience for shorts is often new and emerging short filmmakers themselves who are looking to see what's being made out there, what they might be able to get to grips with, obviously without the financing of features, but also young audiences. We feel, and the feedback we get, find that short films resonate with them because they are made by people of a similar age dealing with similar things who maybe don't go on to have opportunities to make features. So we get really positive feedback from young audiences, so it's another thing to try. That is pretty much it from an overview. I will hand over to Ren in just a second, who's going to talk about the next few programs that are coming up. We're working with Tull Stories, Johnny Tull, if some of you will know him, to help us with the distribution side of things. So do feel free to get in touch with us or with him. His email address is there, johnny@tullstories.co.uk. And I've got a little trailer to play. It's only 45 seconds, I think, but hopefully it will work now. And then Ren will take over.
Thank you.
Hi everyone, Ren's here, and thanks. So this is the our 2022 schedule for the upcoming programs, and as you can see, we up for now we work through June. So we've got the January one will be around like new beginnings, but I'm gonna talk through a bit more in depth about the first two programs in a second. And then February is like called Another Side of Love, so something around like for maybe Valentine's Day. I'm not really a fan of Valentine's Day anyway. So the March program would be program together with the British Animation Awards. So it's kind of a best of the films who won the British Animation Awards. And then the April one, it's not tied up already, but I can anticipate it's gonna be a bit more experimental, and it's gonna be like around urban spaces. So basically like bringing together animation, and then as I said, more experimental stuff. After that, we're gonna do something around the something for the Deaf Awareness Week in May, because I mean we've got like some deaf showcases in during the editions of the Encounters Film Festival. And then lately for June, pretty self-explanatory, something around Pride Month, so LGBTQI+ films. And then, as I said, I'm gonna say something a bit more about like our January program, which is called New Beginnings. As you can see there, that's the program copy for the program. And then there are a few stills from the short films we programmed. So basically, like, this whole program taps into those unexpected yet life-changing connections, as well as those moments in which you find yourself in control of your life and deciding which direction you now want to veer towards. Which is something to say that, when you're experiencing like you're stalling in your life, but then something happened and you now know where you should be headed towards. And then a few highlights, we've got like a film which I really loved, which is called Dai by Antonin T. And the film actually won Clermont-Ferrand in 2020. And this film had like quite a big and a successful festival run. And there are like a couple of stunning performances from child actors in this film, so I highly recommend that one. And another film I really loved in this program is Throne of Pinnacles by Mathilde Poquet. An animation film, a French film, very emotive. There are sparse dialogue, suggestive landscape, as the title suggests. It's set in the Death Valley, and it's about like a family, and there are like lack of communication between the parents, but it's completely stunning, like in the aesthetic wise. And then lastly, we've got the February program, Another Side of Love. As I anticipated, we wanted to do something around not really Valentine's Day, which I said I'm not really keen on celebrating in a way. But so what I found we could do is like celebrating the other meanings of love. So I basically decided to explore friendship as another way of like loving someone, but not in a physical way, and also exploring like father-son relationship. And then there's also like my kind of my favorite film, which is absolutely not your typical film for Valentine's Day, which is a horror story. And then but it's absolutely fantastic in terms of like exploring the kind of self-denying connections between that sometimes could happen between people. And it's about a mother caring for a kind of demonic son who's basically like devouring people because of his like unrelenting hunger. But it's absolutely fantastic. I mean, exactly the film you want to watch for like Valentine's Day or like in February, but great. And then also like Welcome to the Ball, it's a really fantastic story about like exploring your gender identity, and it also touch upon like deaf issues. So I think that's it for me. I've got 33 seconds, and then I'm gonna wrap it up now. Thanks.
Apologies, I nearly got tripped up by my own skirt. The next three show and shares will all be pre-recorded, so they'll follow one after the other, and then I'll pop back up at the end.
Hi everybody, my name is Justine Atkinson and I'm from IO Films, which is a film distribution company and also has a focus on film education training. Over the last 12 months or so, we've been developing an app called Curate-It, which is a step-by-step guide for how to curate a film festival or a film series or a screening event. And it's basically to make that knowledge of film curation more accessible within a digital space. So we wanted to move it beyond the confines of educational institutions or organizations to make it so that anyone can access that information. So it's been suggested that online spaces can be really interesting and that they can challenge the production of representations. They can offer participation across geographical borders. I think we've all learned that over the last 18 months or so, that you know the online space is now quite significant and it's sort of changed a lot in the way that we use it. So this, I guess, forms part of that. We wanted it to be more accessible in terms of time, so people can use it, like they can go through the course in their own time, so it can be more flexible with learning, with you know the hours that people are required to learn and give. And it can also be flexible in terms of the audiences that are reached through through the app, and because there's a VOD platform at the end, which I'll get to, so people can you know use that to reach the audiences they intend to, and people can also monetize from the screenings. So the app follows 8 different steps. Each one consists of written information, different activities, reading lists, and a number of different videos featuring film experts, mostly from the UK right now, but we'll expand that as we go forward. It's accessible in English and in French. The films are closed captioned for deaf or hard of hearing users, and it has contrast adjustment as well for those that are visually impaired. It can be used as people can go through it individually or they can work in teams. So they can teams can be created by organizations. So within that you'd have there's a messenger function, either for individuals or for teams, but in teams you'd have your own team that you can talk to and share ideas. So then it's aimed at those that have intermediate or beginning or just starting out in their career in film curation, and it can be accessed either on a desktop or downloaded as an application on a mobile. So the first section is watch it, and within that section, participants, as you'd assume, watch films. So we've partnered with Mubi, and which I'm probably most of you are aware of, independent VOD platform. And also Argo, which is a short film VOD platform. And they both offer 3-month free trials for those that are using the app. And then there's a number of other films who've partnered with the Scottish Documentary Institute, who've given us a number of documentaries. And then there's a few African films on there as well. So that's something that we will expand as well. But so yeah, watch it, they watch the films. Then once they've watched the films, they move on to analyze it. And basically there they learn the processes of film analysis and how each curator comes you know, to a film program with a specific lens through which they view and value film and a context of understanding. So it's to get people thinking about how they view and value films. And there's a couple of activities. So they rate the films that they've watched and watch it. You can see the star system in the third screen there. And then they analyze the film. So they answer, you know, a number of different ways that you can analyze the film. So through language or narrative or aesthetics. So they write about the films that they've watched. After that, they move on to curate it, which is, as you'd imagine, the biggest section in the app. And then through that, they get a theoretical understanding of what film curation is, thinking about what it includes, how it's used in different countries and different places. And the role that film curators play in the film exhibition sector and the power that holds. And there's different things that it includes. So like researching films, budgeting, negotiation, marketing, etc. And then there's activities for them to document their research process. They learn about the different formats that films come in, different venues that they can use, different access measures they can have. The processes of negotiation is laid out. Rights ownership, you see there, and the negotiation process. Okay, and also how to write a call for submissions. And there's also a section where they can develop their own wish list. So add the films that they're looking at and considering. After that, it's finance it. So where to look for funding, how you finance, how you raise a budget to put on a film event, and what's included in that budget. They can complete their own budget. And as an example one, and it just gives them an idea of the corporate, looking at corporate sponsorship, public funding, NGO, trusts and foundations, generating income on their own, and what would be included in a funding application. So thinking about that. Then the next step is market it. So then they think about how to do a marketing strategy, what's included in that, who, and obviously a key part, which also comes in earlier, of who are their audiences, who are they targeting through their event, and how they're going to reach them. So that the idea of market it is to get them to think through different ways they can market the film. So niche marketing or press or print publicity. So it gives them information about all of that. They can create their own press release. There's an example press release. They can watch from the screen of Rafiki, and then there's an activity following that where they write their own. And then the same with writing a synopsis, it gives them an example of how to write a synopsis, and then they can write their own. Following that is execute it. And basically that's a number of different checklists that you need to think about when you're implementing an event. So venue planning, the risk assessment forms, volunteer coordination, technical aspects, evaluation, do you have everything in place that you need to when you're executing your event, and then evaluate it, which is obviously, as we all know, a very key part of any project, the monitoring and evaluation. It's thinking about methods of monitoring, so online forms, printed forms, verbal feedback, the ethics around that. Photography, like how, you know, all the different things that you think about when the event's taking place that you need to implement. Then they read a monitoring form, and then they can complete their own report on how they think their event went. After that, so at the end, the last section is screen it, and you can sort of see it here. It's basically a VOD platform. This is where the film would be shown. You'd click on that and it'd expand to a film. So that's a public facing part of the site. Obviously the participants can hold events in person, but they can also have access to the online platform. And through that, they get each person that, you know, curates a film receives 70% of the box office that's generated. If they charge, they can also hold it for free. And then also we've created a directory. So every curator that goes through the program creates a profile and it includes their events. So they're held online and a little bit about them and their curatorial interests. So that, you know, that can become sort of a database of different curators. That's it in a nutshell. It can be used, I think, by lots of different configurations, from film organizations, film festivals, cinemas, individuals. I welcome questions. I'm sorry I can't be with you in person, but if you have any questions, then you can just email me on j.atkinson@aya-films.org. The website for Curate It, which is curate-it.co.uk. And then if you want to follow us on social media, it's @WeCurateIt. Thanks so much. And yeah, do get in touch if you have any questions.
Hello, thanks for having me. My name is Elena Zini and I'm the founder of Screen Language. Today, I'd like to talk about disability access materials and about our experience working with exhibitors. We are an Edinburgh-based translation and accessibility company. We have been working in this field for over 10 years. Our main products are subtitles, audio description, and other accessibility and translation products. We like to work with research and industry leaders to make sure that in this ever-changing field, our products are always up to the very best standards. We focus on quality, on the high standards of our products that are cinema ready, and on using technology for good and to produce the best products we can. In all this, collaborating with exhibitors is essential. Cinemas are the main users of our products, and we don't often get to communicate directly with them because our clients are on the other side, so directors, distributors, and producers. So we really hope that this presentation can work as a conversation starter, and that you can use my contact details that will be at the end of the video to get in touch, ask any questions, clarify, tell me what you think of all this. So I'd like to tell you our perspective on creating these access materials. So normally when we get contacted by our clients, they come to us with a list that is given to them by their founders, sometimes BFI or Screen Scotland. That includes a narrative audio track for the visually impaired, open captions, closed captions, hearing impaired captions, and visually impaired narrative audio track. This list and its description and its language can be a little bit daunting, and we don't expect our clients to know exactly what it all means. On the other hand, obviously we hope that exhibitors know most of it and are familiar with this language. But we like to sum it all up into main products: subtitles and audio description, subtitles for the deaf and hard of hearing, and audio description for the visually impaired. Subtitles can sometimes be called closed captions, and this is just a different name, but we prefer to call them subtitles for the deaf and hard of hearing. We find it a little bit clearer. Subtitles can be supplied as many different formats. Here there's a screenshot taken from our software that you probably can't see, but it's just to give you an idea of how many formats there are and that we can provide. The main ones that we are required by cinema productions are sidecar files, so SRTs, STLs, sometimes VTTs. These are used for working and implementing into editing software as well. Burned in, so the subtitles can be taken and then burned in by the film editors themselves. And XML for DCPs. These can be supplied as either images or text files. And I'll tell you a little bit about the difference between the two later. Audio description is supplied as a mono and mixed stereo wave track. And what you need when you create a DCP is a mono track. So you will hear the voice of an audio description actor reading a description of what's going on in the film, all the visual information that is lacking if you cannot see the scene. And now I'll go on to telling you what are the issues, the main issues and difficulties we encountered once we have delivered our files and then we get the feedback from the DCP makers or the exhibitors. So when we're lucky enough to get contacted back by DCP maker, sometimes they show us what the subtitles look like in their software or on the cinema screen, and they might not be looking like we want them to look. The reason is that some of the formats are listed above, which is what we are required by our clients to create, do not carry all the information we would like them to carry. So they don't list what the font, what color, what size, what outline we would like, we set. So all this is lost. And so when the subtitles are actually used, they look very different from the way we would like them to look. This is an example of, you know, the way we saw the subtitles, which is the smaller text, which is more defined with a border, with an outline, and the subtitle in the background is the way it had been imported. I would put some recommendations. Some of them are obvious, some of them aren't, but we find that things sometimes these basic criteria are skipped. So we'll say them anyway and hope no one gets offended. So always test the subtitles prior to screening and let us know or let the directors, producers know that they don't, if they don't look right. The solution we found is the best so far is creating and requiring the subtitling company to create a DCDM folder with a PNG or an XML associated with PNG images, which means that the subtitles should look exactly the way we set them. Again, it would be great because we can't preview the DCP. It would be great to hear back, even just taking a screenshot of the way it's looking on your screen, sending it back to us, and we will tell you if it's okay or not. Other issues, surprising issues we have encountered is that we were working on foreign language films and the subtitles hadn't been put on. So obviously you would say it's obvious. Always test the subtitles prior to the screening. And you should check the film in its entirety because there might be some foreign language coming up at some point. And if the subtitles aren't burnt in, the subtitles won't show up if they're not activated in the DCP. Also, titling the subtitles in the DCP for the DCP makers appropriately is a very good way to make sure the projectionists know that they do need to turn them always on. With regards to audio description, we found that sometimes the description wasn't available or wasn't working where we knew that it was supposed to be there because we had worked with the DCP makers. So we strongly encourage exhibitors to always test if the description is working prior to the screening, especially if the description is if the screening is advertised as having audio description. Reversely, it may be that the audio description is available, but the screening isn't advertised as an audio described one. So we would encourage exhibitors to always check the availability of the description in the DCP and advertise the film appropriately so that if there is someone who requires it, they can confidently go to the cinema and use it. Sometimes the headsets aren't working, so the headsets need to be tested for battery, their battery operated devices, or for any other technical failure. There's different kinds of headsets, and it's important that all members of staff are familiar with how they work. And in general, to accessibility, we found that according to research, the human factor is essential in making sure that venues are perceived as accessible. So the staff, the front of house staff need to know where the headsets are located, make them available, be able to test them, turn them on, check it's on the right channel, checking, making sure they can show people where the volume is, whether there is an enhanced soundtrack option, which is useful to some visually impaired people. And in general, implementing someone, a consultant or a representative of disability and access requirements among the members of staff would be something we would strongly encourage. Obviously, always use professional disability access material suppliers. And as I mentioned before, do not worry about checking if things don't look or sound right, because most things can be adjusted by the professional subtitles or the description creator. So if the subtitles look too big or too small, if the font doesn't look right or looks ugly, if the color, the border, the definition doesn't look right, check that the subtitles are synchronized at the start, middle, of end. Obviously, we do that check, but it may be that we have been working on the wrong version of the film or with the wrong frame rate. So we need to work together to make sure this is all correct when it reaches the audience position as well. Well, this can be changed by us. Audio description needs to be synchronized and the volume needs to be right. These were the main points I wanted to make. Thank you so much for listening. And I hope you found some of it interesting, and I'd be delighted to hear back from you and hopefully work together one day. So I'm Elena at screenlanguage.co.uk, and our website is screenlanguage.co.uk. You'll also find our show reel in there that shows a little bit of an example of audio description and subtitles, and also a list of some of our projects in there. Thank you so much and enjoy your festival. Bye-bye.
Hi, my name is Amanda Rogers from Cinetopia.
And I'm Isabel Salomon from Edinburgh Cinema Club. And we've been involved in producing and directing a new initiative called Cinescapes in Scotland over the course of the last year. And we want to show and share a few highlights from our year of hyperlocal outdoor screenings in Scotland.
We're very sorry we couldn't make it there in person. Huge fan of This Way Up, and hopefully we'll be there next year. But currently working on a documentary, Cinetopia doc screenings, in the next week here in Edinburgh.
Today, though, we're together going to tell you about how Cinescapes came about from conception and execution, from our inaugural film festival season to our archive film program we did around Edinburgh called Redrawing Edinburgh, as well as the challenges we faced and the feedback we received around showcasing films for locals around the concept of place.
The idea of Cinescapes came primarily from the first lockdown due to the COVID-19 crisis. We had already run our first outdoor film event in our hometown of Leith alongside food and drink pairings in 2019. But during the crisis, we were struck by initiatives across the world that use cinema projected onto walls as a way to connect with communities. Specifically on small scales, we saw this in Italy and Cork, Ireland, but also through the fantastic Windowflix project in Berlin, which projected films in courtyards all across the city. What interested us about this Windowflix project specifically is how they used architecture and space as inspiration for the cinema experience, as well as offered an absolutely unique experience for these small hyperlocal communities in times when going to the cinema was just not possible. We wanted to look at this initiative and see how we could translate that onto a Scottish landscape, both in urban and rural settings.
And what makes Cinescapes really unique to these other projects that came before us is how we tie our programming to the locality and the landscape that inspired it. We wanted to share a program in a hybrid fashion to the local communities in person and online at a time when outdoor and hyperlocal was necessary and people were disconnected while longing for connection. What Cinescapes does is celebrate these local stories on a global scale, offering visibility online to those who might not be able to partake in the local events. Working with local food and drink vendors is again fundamental. It's something we've championed for a long time, holding that mentality that you eat, drink, shop local, supporting them and building a narrative around who they are and what they do during this difficult time is what Cinescapes is about. We celebrate, connect, and support local. And our announcement of our initial film festival program brought some unexpected but exciting international attention. We started off in our hometown of Leith, and the film that most represents the area and its notoriety is, of course, Trainspotting, which, as film experts know, was largely not shot in Leith but in Glasgow. But it is based on a novel by Irvine Welsh set in Leith, as well as Trainspotting 2, which years later made more effort to be filmed in the location that inspired the story. And this is why it was so important to us to screen these two beloved films together for the first time to this local audience.
Our second film screening was based in Glasgow alongside WAF, the World of International Film Festival, with Under the Skin at Film City Glasgow. As one of our favorite films, the film was shot on the streets of Glasgow with Scarlett Johansson remaining undetected throughout the shooting. We ran an online Q&A with Under the Skin expert Maureen Foster to learn about the production of the film, but how it tied specifically to the city and to Scotland in general.
And then our third film was Ne Passeron. It's a film about a group of Rolls-Royce factory workers from East Kilbride who made a bold statement of solidarity with the Chilean people in the mid-70s. Online, we showed a Q&A with two of the four seminal men of the film and the director Felipe, where we heard about their story and the East Kilbride connection. We brought the film home to its first outdoor screening in the area at Calder Glen Country Park with the help of the South Lanarkshire Council.
Our fourth film was Aquarella, a spectacular documentary directed by Victor Kosakowski about water. and we wanted to share it in a very aquatic and majestic setting. So that's why we partnered with the amazing Oban Phoenix Cinema team to bring this local screening to the top of the town at McCaig's Tower. When we interviewed Aymara Reyes, the producer of Vaccarella, who's based in Glasgow, we learned that it was through a trip to Oban that the director and producers really cemented their relationship and made this multi-year and multi-million dollar endeavor happen.
And finally, we took the festival home with The Illusionist. It's a personal favorite of both Amanda's and myself, and a true love letter to the city of Edinburgh. The original screenplay by Jax Tutty was based in Czechoslovakia, but it was through the brilliant animator director Sylvain Chomet's time living in Edinburgh and through his love for this city that saw him choose to animate our Edinburgh streets. And under the glow of Edinburgh Castle on Princess Street, which largely features in the film, we brought this to Edinburgh locals to their location on a relatively tame November night as the finale of our film festival. And while the weather was not always our friend, our local audiences were always steadfast and keen to stay with us on our journey across the country. It was an intense labor of love in which we learned so much along the way.
With Cinescapes, we didn't just want to show the films in the locations that they were inspired by. We wanted to talk about them and how they related to the location specifically. Our curation was always about how to tie location and concept, but add bonus material, which was always conceived to enlighten our audiences on why location matters. The first film we planned, for example, we screened online, was From Scotland with Love, an archive film opus that showcases Scotland over the years through an intense dive into the archives. Set to music by Fife local King Creosote. We showed this in collaboration with Fife Cultural Trust and their Spring Festival and our friend Dan Brown. But we also learned when talking to the film's director that this film was initially conceived in Fife, in Anstruther, as we had imagined screening it originally. So we projected the film onto buildings in Fife and Anstruther and showed it as part of our online program. Speaking of archive, at the very beginning, we've always wanted to incorporate archive film into the programming and curation. And this was the most obvious way for us to incorporate the very local into our program. Nothing makes this clearer than our experience with showcasing archive film in local neighborhoods in Edinburgh during this September through our initiative, Cinescapes Redrawing Edinburgh. In this case, we worked with the Edinburgh City Archives to highlight their anniversary program around the amalgamation of various boundary locations, parishes, and boroughs that ultimately coincide with an act that improved transportation in and out of city center 100 years ago. Our idea started small, showcasing winter footage as part of Cinescapes a la Window Flicks and our original concept around the idea of using projection mapping with our colleagues at Double Take Projections. But what grew out as a project was a 9-month creative production that involved a large effort from both myself as creative producer, but also screenwriter Alistair Rutherford, local jazz duo Diwali, who created the soundtrack, and various other smaller local historical organizations who helped us find archive material to incorporate as well. This project was sponsored and part of the New Directions BFI Screen Heritage Program.
The Redrawing Edinburgh project, which took place in Edinburgh over the course of 3 weeks in September, saw over 1,000 residents view this archive film project outdoors and online, welcoming many who had not attended or gathered in local events like these since the global COVID-19 pandemic started. The popularity and overwhelmingly positive experience our audience had in showing archive film in this way showed us the potential again to attach local moving image material in new and unique ways to communities outside of city centres and within very hyperlocal communities.
Like the Cinescapes Festival, Cinescapes Redrawing Edinburgh was a labour of love for showcasing locally inspired materials in outdoor settings safely, but in ways they might have never been seen before or ever seen at all. There are no films in the National Library of Scotland's Moving Image Archive that are solely dedicated to the areas of Corstorphine and Liberton, all of those who really have their own identities beyond just being part of Edinburgh. We needed to extract and amalgamate these stories together and curate them into a creative production, working with both local creatives and local historic societies to make this full vision happen. The process of finding and accessing material from the archives was not only a 9-month process from the archive research team, it was an expensive one. And it involved a process that continues to go on today. It's an ongoing project. Archive film, we believe, is essentially a community resource, one that should be shown within its community and accessible to local small groups who ultimately see the value in connecting with those stories specifically. Whether it brings back memories or creates ties between generations, our Redrawing Edinburgh project really showcased what it meant to be a Leather or a Corrie rather than just being from Edinburgh. We had no idea when we started Cinescapes how long and challenging this journey would be, whether it would be from a logistical or financial perspective. My hope is that someday this won't be the case and local communities can show similar projects themselves more easily.
And we've really seen through all of these projects how much there is an appetite for this and how much communities are wanting this experience more. And while Cinescapes was a small idea about highlighting local films and the locations that they were filmed in or inspired by, it grew into this bigger one, one that involved so many organizations, collaborators, and time and money. I suppose our question to you is whether this is sustainable for small local independent exhibitors such as ourselves, who had this year due to COVID and the need to reinvent ourselves to explore this vision and dream, but also to small local charities who want to engage with their screen heritage but have little access to it. Can we make hyperlocal film experiences more accessible to the communities who want to see them? We definitely hope that we can. Thank you. We hope you'll follow us at cinescapes.co.uk and hopefully we'll see you in 2022.
Some exciting provocations there at the end of that one. And we've got one more show and share to go. So I'd like to welcome Yi Wang to the stage.
Hi. I know we are a bit running late, so I will try to be quick. My name is Yi. I'm here to talk about Curate-It. Curate-It is an LGBTQ plus film festival that showcases Israeli seen queer cinema from East and Southeast Asia and seeks to amplify the voice of Asian communities in the UK. To kick off my presentation, I would like to throw four questions to the floor. I know it's quite an aggressive start, so yeah. So when is the last time you saw an East or Southeast Asian LGBTQ plus films? What was it about? When was it made? And where did you watch it? The reason for raising these four questions is that they link to my personal experience as a film goer who want to see queer Asian cinema in the UK. And these observations then become my motivation for creating Curate-It. The first one is visibility. So Asians are one of the most fastest growing ethnic groups in the UK, but it seems like we still lack understanding about them. Apart from those appearances in major blockbusters, we don't often see a lot of Asian representations. And not to mention films about queer Asian communities, as they are double marginalized by race and sexuality, resulting in exclusion from the mainstream discourse. And the second one is relevance. When it comes to queer Asian cinema, there are a few classics we talk about and adore. For example, Wong Kar-wai's Happy Together, a film that was made 20 years ago. The other one will be Funeral Parade of Roses from Japan, an absolute masterpiece, but it was also made over half of a century ago. And I think we need to see more films are current and relevant to us and that represents the life experience of queer people living in today's society. And the third one is authenticity. Far too often, queer Asian communities are portrayed as a group of sufferers who are trapped by social oppressions or traditional cultural norms, which may be true for some people. But however, joy and happiness are also part of our experience of being queer. And we need to bring more films from different perspectives and give queer Asian characters more three-dimensional narratives. And the last one is accessibility. From my personal experience, most of the screening events related to such topics were usually held on university campuses run by academics with research interest in no matter Asian cinemas or queer cinemas. Beyond academic settings, it is pretty hard to find films in cinemas. And I think we should bring them to the public and give audience a chance to discover, explore, and actually decide if they want to get tickets to see these films. I'm not a fan of labeling, but sometimes I do feel labeling help us to realize what are we missing. As a Taiwanese and East Asian, a first generation immigrant, and as a queer person, and also the most importantly, as an audience member, I don't see a lot of films, I don't see enough of my heritage, my identity, and my stories being told on the big screen. Therefore, even though I didn't have any film-related background, I had this thought of why not start a film festival that shares films that I think deserve to be seen. So with generous support from many founders and many, many friends, cinema partners, Curate-It began with me typing my first questions on Google, how to show a film in a cinema. So the first edition of Curate-It was initially planned for April 2020, and we all know what happened then. So the multiple lockdowns significantly disrupted our festival, and it took us 18 months until this June we finally finished all the screenings we programmed for our first edition. And to give you a sense of what Curate-It looks like, I would like to share a trailer with you. And the second edition of Curate-It returned this December for 12 days, finally, 12 days festival across 8 cinemas in London. And we are currently, we have been touring some of our festival highlights in different cities such as Manchester, Nottingham, Birmingham, Edinburgh in the past few weeks. And we are going to showroom Sheffield this and next week. And so here's a trailer for our this year's edition. So you can see here are the cinemas and venues we've worked with over the past 2 years. And some numbers summarize our very adventurous journey. So with 2 film festivals and several online series and events, we've screened 98 films, These include feature films, short films, documentaries, 35mm retrospectives, and artist moving image works from 20 countries across East and Southeast Asia and beyond. We've worked with 18 venues in 8 cities, and together we've welcomed more than 1,500 people to join us in person and receive over 5,000 online viewers for our online content. There are many ways to appreciate films, and for myself and for Curate-It, film is one of the most direct and accessible mediums. It is able to shine a light on issues that people weren't aware of before, and has the possibility of bridging the cultural distance between us. I hope that Curate-It can be a platform for our communities to share our voices, and also for people to understand what it means to be Asian and queer today. So I'm here to inviting all of you here, whether you are from cinemas, festivals, community space, or just simply are interested in bringing queer Asian cinema to your neighborhood or audience. I hope we can all collaborate together and build a more colorful, diverse, and vibrant film exhibition landscape. And thank you, that's all from me.
Thank you, and thank you also to everyone that contributed to the show and share presentations. I would like to, just before a short break and our last session, introduce a sponsor of This Way Up that we're happy to have sponsoring, Malcolm McMillan from the Box Office Company, and he'll be speaking just after a very brief video.
That music, that was Birth of a Hero, apparently. That was what it was called anyway. That's not me, that's TWU, and I'd like to thank Adam and Sandra, who I've met, and all the other team members behind this, to just say thank you very much for inviting me and allowing us to sponsor this event for the first time. Really grateful for the opportunity. We're probably the company. I don't know how many people in this room have heard of the Box Office Company. Does anyone raise a hand? Not very many, and it's not really surprising. We've changed our name 4 times in the last 3 years. We are a global company, but we like to act local. I run the UK division. We work in the online space, and I mean across the whole online space. But I want to talk to you about 2 or 3 of the things that we do, just to give you a bit of insight into who we are, and also just to remind you just how important the online space is. I mean, that video, this big sort of statement about the mobile phone being the new foyer, I can back that up, honestly. Since before the pandemic, we were looking at online share of transactions on one of these, at 67% of all tickets being sold, and this is across about 20 or 30 cinemas, both here and in the US. When we looked at the figures last month and the month before, that figure had risen to 80% of all online sales going through a mobile phone. And on top of that, and I don't have empirical data to back this up, but on the basis of conversations we've had with most of our clients, we're looking at high numbers of tickets being sold online, full stop. Again, that's jumped massively. And just to give it, I can't really see that well because of the light. But could is there anyone in this room who runs a cinema who is getting less than 50% of their tickets sold online? Anyone? What about 60%? I can't see any hands yet. 60% of your tickets sold online? Less than 60%. Okay, and that's probably about right. I think before the pandemic, the sort of average was 35 to 45%, but I'm hearing figures of 90%, 95%. And I know Bond saved us a few weeks ago, but Spider-Man looks like it's going to do quite well as well. I appreciate the audience here is less interested in Spider-Man, but money is money, and hopefully that will help help fuel the cinema resurgence, which we're all hoping will come back, and we're all part of this journey. We're sort of talking about the mobile phone being the new foyer, because you can basically do anything you like now. All the things that you could do in the foyer, and I know it's impersonal, but all the things you can do in the foyer, you can now do on a mobile phone. We can refund tickets on a mobile phone to customers. They can obviously buy tickets, they can buy concessions, all these things can be done on a mobile phone. And I think that's the reality. And I just wanted to make sure you had that insight, because it is clearly a very important way to communicate and engage with your customers. So that's the first thing I wanted to say. And the good news is that the box office company have a whole range of very affordable, some off-the-shelf products, but they can be customized. Websites, mobile apps, ticketing solutions, CRM tools. They are designed for customers, exhibitors, specifically for exhibitors. We don't work outside the cinema industry, and of large and small. We're not discriminating. And in fact, actually, I think some of the small operators will benefit from our expertise that we're generating with the larger exhibitors who are doing a lot more of the more complex, innovative stuff. And that stuff can be funneled back into our products, and you guys can benefit from that. So that's something we're really keen to get across. And we don't do a great deal of work here, but we do work with 300 independent exhibitors in the States, and we do work with 200 independent exhibitors in France. So we do have a big experience in this sector, but nobody knows who we are here, so that's why I'm here. The other things I wanted just to quickly talk to you about, the word free, I mean it. It is free. We supply your show times as exhibitors. We supply your show times to Google, and we supply them to IMDb, and we supply them to Facebook in some areas. We do that worldwide, but we pride ourselves on the quality of the data that we supply to Google, and that's what they pay us for. We offer that service to you guys. We offer that service, it's totally free, but we do need to get the data from you to pass through to Google. And the importance of this, for you, from your perspective, is that somewhere in the region, 15 to 20% of your tickets will be sold as a result of a referral from Google. So if your data is not correct in any way, give me a call. I'll put you in touch with the right person. If your show times are showing, and the watershed needs to talk to me, if your show time is showing, but there's no link to your ticketing pages on your website, then you need to talk to me, because there's a pretty good chance that we can get that as a link, and that will improve accessibility of your show times and your ticketing to the customers that you need. So, as I say, it's a completely free service. I am your man. Grab there was a QR code up there, but come and find me in Watershed 3. Watershed 3, and I'll give you a card. I'll leave some cards on the table so you can just pick one up. But get in touch with me and I'll sort that out for you. I'm genuinely delighted to do that, because we're all in the business of trying to make sure all our audiences can see our films. Switching slightly, we are a global company. We have a magazine. We had Hugh Odling-Smee. Are you here, Hugh? Oh, right, okay, it's prepping for the next session. Hugh was took part in a podcast, a Box Office Pro podcast, that we've done 98, nearly 100 episodes of this since the beginning of the pandemic. He took part in that last week as part of the promotion for this event. Now, we are predominantly an American trade magazine for NATO, the National Association of Theatre Owners, but it's an English-speaking publication. We have an online version. It's free to sign up, subscription, give you great insight into what's happening in the independent sector in the States, for example. Not completely dissimilar issues and challenges as we're facing here. So hopefully that's useful. As I say, sign up. The podcasts are very, very, really good listen. They're about half an hour long. They're up to date, a little bit American, but we are, as I say, he was on it last week, and we had Serena Gill, who's the Everyman's programming, head of programming, on a couple of weeks before that. So we're looking for content as well. So have a listen, and if you've got any thoughts and or any stories that you'd like to share more widely, please let me know, and I'll put you in touch with our editor, who's a very accessible guy and really interested in building an audience over here. So please feel free to pass that on as well. That's it really for what I'd say, that the key things that may interest you as an exhibition, as cinema industry experts, that we do as a company. I'm also going to do a little plug for my son, who is serving the cocktails tonight. He's 22 years old. He started a company during lockdown. They've made this cocktail in a box. It's 3 liters of cocktail, ready-made cocktail in a box. You'll be able to sample it tonight. There are two options: mojito and sex on the beach. We like to be inclusive, so everyone can drink those. But the slightly more kind of commercial side of that is he is looking for a market, and this is a cocktail that can be served in volume very quickly. So it's great for events. And thinking of events, and I know you all put on events in your cinemas, there's an opportunity there to serve something which is a little bit different to the normal beer and wine, but easy to serve, doesn't need a great deal of training or anything like that, and might enhance a night out for 20 plus people coming to your cinema. So anyway, I hope you enjoy the drinks later on tonight, and I hope to meet a few of you while we're there. Thanks very much.
How do you manage your cinema's digital marketing? Well, you do the best you can while focusing on running your theater. Digital marketing or web development may not be your specialty. It's time for something easier, something future-proofed. The Box Office Company has developed the tools and services to empower you to take charge of your digital marketing, and we are committed to continuously evolve with the latest trends and provide a seamless moviegoer experience. First, we grow your website and brand traffic. Use our personalized email marketing solutions, implement SEO and pay-per-click strategies, and of course, we will display your theater and showtimes on Google and other search platforms. Next, we will convert your traffic into moviegoers. Our websites, integrated online ticketing solutions, mobile apps, and more are built to make it easy and secure for your moviegoers to purchase tickets online. Finally, we'll help you to understand your online moviegoers' purchase behavior and allow you to monitor your ticket and food and beverage sales in real time. Our suite of analytic tools will allow you to make informed decisions and build your marketing strategy. Get all the tools you need to run your cinema's digital marketing more effectively and plan for the future of your business with the Box Office Company. Contact us to get started at sales@boxoffice.com.